Hey, welcome to Speechless. We're glad to have you here on this 4th of July weekend. We are live from the SCC studios in White Bear Lake, also showing live out of SPNN in St. Paul. And if you have questions or comments on today's show, be sure to call in at 651-747-3830. If you don't want to call in, you can send an email there. You see the email speechlessmn@gmail.com. And since it's July 4th and coming up tomorrow, and I want this show to emphasize keeping your independence. And so the subject matter today, my guest will be on later, Andrew Henderson, and it's going to be how to interact with the police or how to talk to the police, and how to protect your liberties when you are confronted with the police and not give them up. And we want to get you in the right frame of mind, get you calmed down, and you know the police are there supposedly to protect your liberties, but you are the only one, the final person who has to protect your liberties. It's up to you. So we want you to understand what's going on in the process when they pull you over for traffic stops, when they knock on your door, when you're walking along the street and the police come up to you. What are your rights? How do you interact? So we're going to talk about that. We got some fascinating stories in the process of how all this take place. But before that, I have a few questions for you on the 4th of July. Well, I had six questions here, but you know, we got some fascinating information, so I'm just going to go through a couple of them. But they deal with your liberties here. And so, some things you may have not known about the 4th of July and what some of the signers of the Declaration of Independence had to go through. But here's one question. Which signer of the Declaration spent months rarely sleeping two nights in the same place in order to avoid the British who were seeking for him to punish him for having signed the Declaration of Independence? Do you know who that would be? Well, I didn't know, but somebody else gave me these questions. That would be John Hart. But here's a understand this. The British at that point in time were a tyrannical government to the people in America. And the Americans rose up and signed this Declaration of Independence, gave the grievance to Britain, and said, hey, here's the problems. Here's what you're doing. Here's what we object to. We're forming a new government. And John Hart, though, had to sleep in different places night after night after night for months and months in order to protect his life, his God-given life. So, you know, sometimes that may be necessary when a government gets tyrannical. Another question here that I knew part of the answer to, but didn't know the other part. The bell that was rung after the Declaration was approved on July 8th later became known by what title? Of course, the Liberty Bell. We know that. But why did it receive that title and when? Now, I even went to wherever they have the Liberty Bell. I don't think it's in Is it in Williamsburg now? Or Philadelphia. I think it's in Williamsburg. And this is when I was a kid. But I did not understand that it was not named the Liberty Bell until decades later. And it became an important symbol of the abolition movement. That was the freed of the slaves. And it was because of the Bible verse that was on the top. It said, Leviticus 25:10, proclaim liberty throughout the land to all the inhabitants thereof. And so the Liberty Bell only has a connotation of liberty from Britain, but also freeing the slaves, a double meaning there. So some interesting 4th of July facts going on. Well, I bring that up because it's still important that people still have the responsibility to hold their government accountable. The people are a checks and balance on their government too. And we have citizens all over the state who are figuring this out and figuring out how do we do this. And one such person was Lauren Cedarstrom from the city of Grant, who filed a complaint. Data practice complaint. He filed an open meeting violation against Tom Carr, the mayor of Grant, Jeff Huber, city council, Tina Loben, city council member, and John Doe, filed this complaint, and they were ordered to mediation. In other words, if you violate open meeting laws, you may have to, as a mayor, as a city council member, you're going to get a $300 fine, and you can only get them three times. If you get three open meeting violations, you're out of office. You vacated the seat, you're kicked out. And this is kind of the first lawsuit brought against Tom Carr. And I think rightly so, the judge is saying, hey, you know, let's get this right. Even though this is all in law and their city managers and their people should know what to do, this is going to be the first notice. This is a warning. It's kind of like getting pulled over by the police and they say, well, you know, your record's clean. You know, this is a warning. Behave, you know, move on. Kind of that type of situation. And the judge ordered it to mediation, and it went to mediation. And in that mediation, I'm not going to go with the first thing that was ordered because it just really seemed bizarre. I'm going to save that to the last. But it ordered the clerk administrator to attend classes on Minnesota data practices and open meeting laws. And that had to be done as soon as possible and no later than a year. So it'll be interesting to see how soon they do that. The second issue that the city had to do is the clerk administrator, as soon as practical, schedule an administrative report on the agenda of a regular city council meeting where he shall provide a report to the council that outlines the requirements of the Minnesota Data Practices Act and the Minnesota Open Meeting Laws, in that the regular council meetings are customarily cablecast for viewing by the public. The administrative report shall be cablecast as a normal agenda item without exceptions. So the city of Grant was kind of playing games with whether their meetings would be on cable, as far as I understand, and especially the Charter Commission. And I believe this covers that Charter Commission because it is part of the city, that those weren't being recorded and now have to be recorded for the open meeting laws. So that was a big win in that mediation. The third aspect, as soon as practical, but in no event later than 9 months after entry, the city of Grant, together with its attorney, shall draft, design, and print a pamphlet for use by the public, which outlines a process for the public's access to public data under Minnesota Data Practices Act. So they got to have this flyer that says, hey, here's how you get information on us. And they have to have a mandatory notice and meeting requirements under the Minnesota Open Meeting Laws for public policy. So that's got to be printed and available to the public. And that has to be provided to the plaintiff's attorney for review and approval. And upon final printing, the pamphlet shall be available in a conspicuous location at all city meetings of a public body, as well as available upon request. So that's a big win. So the city council members and the mayor are not fined. It doesn't get a strike against them. They should have known this. Puts them on notice. They have to change their behavior. But in something that's really weird, the first part of the order was that Lauren Cedarstrom, who brought this open meeting law violation, was ordered that if he brought another one without an attorney present, he would be fined $7,500 for bringing a suit or bringing notice of an open meeting violation. And I don't get that. And there's a certain amount taken off for some reason, $600 and about $700 taken off. So if within 2 years, Lawrence Cederson comes and files a open meeting law violation without an attorney, he would owe $7,500. But he basically won the case, except this is hanging over his head. And I don't get that. Maybe it's part of the negotiation process that took place in order to give the other side something. But I don't know why a judge would approve of that, because every citizen has a right and shouldn't have this restriction put on them. I don't get that. Where our law says these restrictions, open meeting law violations, are already written into law and they should know what they are. So I don't get that. But we have a caller on the line. Caller, do you have a comment or question?
Well, thank you very much. I'm going to try to respond to some of this. This is Diana Longgren.
Oh, hi, Diana.
The phone line into the studio there this evening has a very bad hum to it.
Yes, it does.
I could hear some of what you were talking about, and I can speak from my experience on this case, because I was the attorney that came on board to assist Mr. Cederson in the matter.
All right.
And when the judge determined that we should go to mediation, he thought it would be important to go to somebody who was familiar with the data practices and open meeting law statute.
Right.
So I had recommended Don Gemberling if he was interested in being a mediator.
And he is an expert. That's absolutely,
And so it appeared that opposing counsel wasn't really familiar with who he was, but since it seemed like the judge was on board with going with Mr. Gemberling, that's who went with. The mediation, I felt, was very successful.
Uh-huh.
We came forward with having a really big win for the citizens of Grant.
I think so, yes.
And there were many other concerns that Mr. Cederstrom had with it regard to other incidents where data was not made available to citizens, or that the Practices Act, maybe citizens didn't know how to implement it, or that there were violations of the open meeting law. And so I think Mr. Gemberling, what he was in his mediation role, his whole goal was, well, how can we set a good process for the citizens and for the city so that everybody has a clear expectation of what to look forward to going forward, considering that, you know, each side has their own positions on this. So we felt very successful. The issue about the attorney fees is that the City of Grant's attorney made a motion for an award of attorney's fees because he was claiming that the litigation was frivolous. Now, I will say that there were also incidences where the opposing counsel caused some unnecessary actions that we had to engage in because of certain scheduling issues and other issues that were involved. And it was after the mediation was completed successfully that the attorney representing Grant wanted to pursue his attorney fees.
Sure.
And so that issue of attorney fees was that was not part of the mediation. That was actually something that had been reserved to the judge. And I think that the judge, in his effort to basically split the baby with regard to attorney fees, because I also had a claim for attorney fees, that is what he came up with to kind of keep the peace between the city, the judicial system, and the court. Keep in mind that this particular law firm that represents the City of Grant has substantial representation of many municipalities in Washington County. And so, you know, they're in court quite often. They are very familiar to the judges within Washington County, and I think that there was this, you know, let's see how we can best do a compromise so that in the end nobody has attorney's fees. And I think that the judge felt that because there were a couple claims in the original complaint that maybe weren't as well-founded as they could have been,
okay.
but there were other claims that were well-founded.
Okay.
So I think that he was just requesting that the next time that the citizens go forward that they just make sure that they have vetted all their claims, and that's it. So I,
okay.
that's pretty much, I think, how that all slipped out in the end. So, but we did feel very, very happy with the results for the citizens of Grant.
Absolutely.
And the state says that it's going to be put into the process.
Yeah.
And so I'm going to sign off now so that
okay.
I can hear your comments because
right.
of the buzz on the line.
Well, maybe I can try to ask one question. Was there any penalty for Grant potentially coming up? Could you
well,
hear that?
The only penalty for Grant, the only penalty for Grant really is that, I mean, they are ordered by this order to do what they must do. And I conceivably, if they don't complete those, the requirements under the order, well, then they could be, you know, contempt of court.
They could be.
But as long as they fulfill those requirements that are set forth
okay.
in that order, then they have satisfied the order.
So it's contempt of court or another open meeting law violation if they actually violate the open meeting laws. But that would have to be brought by an attorney on behalf of the client. Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. All
yes,
right.
That's right.
Well, I mean, it's a good education, and my understanding, the Lawrence Hederstrom still had to dish out some money for attorney's fees. Each side had to pay their own, but he held the government accountable in this deal. Yeah, it's just interesting to see how that works, but it really puts the onus on the city of Grant to behave, and they haven't been. The mayor's just, in my opinion, been out of line over and over again, and for Lauren Cedarstrom to step up to the plate and to try to hold him accountable is a big deal, and a lot of credit should go to him for doing that, because it is not easy. It's not something that citizens like to do. They want to live in their peace and their liberty, and to fight the government is not a fun thing to do, because a whole bunch of people make a whole bunch of money of making sure that that doesn't happen, and they're fighting against you. And they make money, and you don't in that process. All right, we're going to move on. Another case, I'm going to go briefly, real quick. Another person fighting for the liberties, and this gets into traffic stops, because we're going to talk about traffic stops, how to talk to the police, what to say. And, of course, I've talked about this person before, Michelle McDonald, running for the Minnesota Supreme Court. And obviously the major news has said, hey, she had a DUI charge against her, still a court hearing, and to come in September. And the important thing to notice here is, well, she came out with a press release, and I think it's coming out tomorrow. I got it ahead of time. You're hearing it here first. The important thing is to understand, when she was pulled over, the officer said she was weaving between the lines, and then that was the reason. Well, she was driving fine. There was actually a court hearing on a probable cause that was thrown out. They have the video. She did nothing wrong. But here's what happened. It was a traffic stop, and more accurately, it was an unlawful pullover. Okay, because there was no reason for that police officer to pull over Michelle McDonald. McDonald asked to see a judge pursuant to Minnesota Statute 169.91, as it was obvious the officer was clearly abusing his authority and using questionable measures to fill his quota. Any citizens can invoke this statute. However, as can be seen from this incident, the system does not take kindly to exposing those who are not playing by the rules. McDonald was held and released from the Rosemont Police Station with no charges filed. I explain that. You're held by the police, you're released, no charges filed. On McDonald's own initiative, she went directly to a hospital for a drug and alcohol blood test to put to rest any question about the incidents. Tests came back zero alcohol and zero drugs. McDonald filed an employee complaint against the police officer for violation of rights, and as well she should, and as well you should if a police officer is violating your rights. In response to that, McDonald received a citation in the mail with five criminal charges, including charges for driving under the influence. If she was driving under the influence, why wasn't she charged right then and there? But this came a couple days later in the mail, after she filed her complaint against the officer. After the police misconduct investigation and summary dismissal, the prosecuting attorney threw the book at McDonald to cover up the wrongful arrest and violation of her civil rights. At a later hearing, even though it was clear that her blood alcohol and drug testing was at zero, the prosecutor insisted that she subpoena the person who drew the blood to court to explain on the stand that less than 0.001%, the baseline meant zero, which she did. Okay, in other words, the person who blew gave the blood test had to come to court and explain what 0.00 meant. Okay, less than 0.001. What does that mean? It means zero. She had to go to court to do that. Unbelievable. This is called harassment by arrest. You know, or we're going to harass you. We're going to make you go through all the hoops, even though we know, as a prosecutor, we know you're innocent. We're going to make you go through it anyway. That's just out harassment, in my opinion. A court date is set for September, which they may or may not postpone, depending on how they think the outcome may help or hurt her campaign. Well, here's where we get into our discussion, and this is why it's important, is how to talk to the police. How to interact with the police when they pull you over. And even if you're an attorney, it may not always work, you know, and it may not go well. But I have on the show my guest, Andrew Henderson, and glad to have you back. We were on just about a month and a half ago talking about your experiences with being pulled over by the police. And so you're going to educate us. Last time it was more about your situation. Today we're going to talk about, you know, what do you do
right
when the police are there and they're asking tons of questions and you don't know what's going on? What do you do? And so, what do you do?
Well, Tim, for most people, it is a pretty intimidating situation.
Yeah.
I mean, you're getting asked questions. There's bright lights around you. I'd say the first thing that anybody should do is always remain calm. It's important to remain calm in that situation, because not only you are under stress, but the officer is under stress too. He or she does not know what they're walking into.
So what I'm hearing you say here, you not only have to think about yourself, you do have to think about them too.
Right.
Because they're coming up to car. They know all the stories of going up to cars and guns being pulled out, and they're dead.
Sure.
And they're shot at. And all they're doing is just a safety check. Your tire may be flat or loosening pressure. You know, you may be drunk.
Mm-hmm.
They may be protecting other people's lives. You know, they don't know, you know, you don't know why they're stopping you.
Sure. You're both strangers to each other at that
right.
point in time. So.
Yeah, absolutely. But you've been pulled over a number of times.
I have.
Okay. So the first thing to do is remain calm.
Right.
And I think what we're going to do is we're going to go through your stop
you kind of break down. Well, explain a little more, then we'll get your video and show how you kind of, you worked through this situation that was taking place. So the police officer, you know, they're nervous, you're nervous. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's nerve-wracking because it seems like there is this attitude of taxation by citation. We're just going to pull you over for any reason we want, and we want that ticket because we need the revenue to pay our income or to come into the city.
You know, some officers behave like that; others don't. I mean,
right.
it's all up to the individual officer how they behave.
Okay.
One thing that I also recommend while in a traffic stop is to always keep your hands on the wheel.
On the steering wheel.
On the steering wheel.
At the bottom or at the top?
I usually put mine at the top because it shows the officer that you have no weapons and that you're not going for anything.
And they can see that coming up behind you.
Yes.
So right away you're putting them at ease that you're respecting them.
Mm-hmm.
That you know that they see, okay, you know to put your hands up there, you're trying to respect them.
That's right. Another thing that I would also recommend is that you only roll down your window 3 to 4 inches, just enough to pass papers through and to communicate with the officer.
Well, that's interesting. You know, why would that be?
Well, so the officers don't have the probable cause to say they smelt something or see more inside your vehicle than what they already have.
So what's wrong with them? I mean, smelling something in the car or seeing something in the car?
Well, I mean, there could be an odor in the car that they could confuse as a drug odor.
Mm-hmm.
And then they would have probable cause to search your car.
I can see where somebody can confuse a body odor as marijuana.
Sure.
You know,
and
some people have it that bad.
Right. And also in Minnesota, there's a plain view rule, which means if you have anything that is illegal in your car, and if an officer sees that, they now have probable cause to search your vehicle.
Okay. So you just want to protect yourself anyway. Well, maybe they see something and they misinterpret what they see.
That could be too, and that has happened in the past.
And then you're just loaded with a whole bunch of problems.
Right.
When you're innocent.
Right.
So it's just really an avenue to protect yourself.
Yes.
Don't most officers, do they respect that 2 inches, an inch and a half that you roll down that window, or do they complain about it?
I've personally never had a problem with that. I've seen videos of some officers having a problem with that and they want it rolled down all the way. There's no real reason to roll it down all the way.
Why would they be saying roll it down all the way?
Well, to smell.
So they want to do a search.
Yeah.
So without probable cause, although in order to pull you over, they have to have probable cause, don't
right.
they?
Yes.
And is there also reasonable suspicion in there? That's a less of a standard, but to pull you over, they got to have probable cause, don't they?
Yes, they
okay.
do.
Okay. And so they have to have something to pull you over. After that, they're kind of, they still can't get in your car, even
no.
with probable cause.
No.
They have no right to go in.
Right.
So they're doing a search as much as they can in the meantime. That's what I hear you saying.
That, yeah.
And so you're trying to limit their search.
Right.
Yeah.
Another thing that I would recommend to you and your viewers is that if you reach for anything, like your driver's license, that you tell the officer what you're doing before you do it. So if you were pulled over and the officer asks you for your driver's license, say, I'm reaching for my wallet, getting my driver's license. That way they know what you're doing and it provides safety for them and you.
You know, one thing I would do is, kind of the question is, when do you do that? I mean, I would take my wallet out once the lights came on, you know, I'd try to find a safe place to pull over. If it was going to take me a while, I'd wave them. just follow me. I see you there. Just come here. I'm going to a safe place. And then I'd pull my wallet out, put it up on the dash right away. Is that really an issue when, you know?
I wouldn't recommend doing that just because when the officer is behind you, they're watching what you're doing. And if you're reaching for things while they're trying to pull you over, it sends up some red flags for them, like that. Okay. You may either be hiding something or, you know, going for a weapon or something.
Okay.
So I would recommend not doing anything until you're asked to by that officer.
But the main thing you said here is that you tell them, or you ask them if you can get your license out of your back pocket. So you're asking and telling them what you're going to do.
That's correct, yes.
So you're getting permission?
Not necessarily permission, but just, you know, saying I'm getting this for you because you asked. I would definitely wait till they ask for it before giving it to them.
So something like my wallet is in my glove compartment, my license is in my wallet, can I go into my glove compartment to retrieve it?
Yeah.
And then they're going to have their light over there helping find it.
Right.
Also looking if there's a gun there. So.
Right.
Or if it's in your back pocket, you tell them my wallet's in the back pocket and driver's license is in there.
Sure.
You know, can I get that? I'm going to get that now. Mm-hmm. And then they know that's cooperating then.
Right, right.
And what else would you do? I mean, how else could you get it? You know? So they expect that.
Right, yes.
Okay. So after that, what do you do?
I would remain as silent as possible. During a traffic stop, police officers are looking for a way to incriminate you. Usually the first question that an officer asks when they come up to your window is, do you know why I pulled you over?
Yes. Yeah, they do that. Definitely. I everybody's heard that question, and it is the first question. Mm-hmm. So it's just kind of, what's going on there?
Sure. Well, the officer is looking for you to admit guilt in some way. If you say, yes, I was speeding, you just admitted guilt, and you're probably going to get a fine for that. I recommend answering questions with questions. So if an officer says, yeah, do you know why I pulled you over? You can respond with something like, why did you pull me over?
Mm-hmm.
I would talk as little as possible, just because they try to get you to talk to incriminate yourself. Police officers are trained to do that. They go through schooling to get people to incriminate themselves.
To engage in a conversation. They're just acting like, oh, this is just run of the mill, just answer my question, this is standard, this is what we do, no big deal.
Right.
But in the meantime, they are trying to get you to admit something that they may not even know of.
Sure, it's either to admit something, or if they suspect you have a DWI, they may want to get you to talk just to be able to smell your breath.
Well, that's a big reason right there. Get you to talk, they may want to smell your breath. Okay. I think the mentality here is, why are they asking this question? Do you know why I pulled you over? I mean, just sitting back and thinking about that, they know why.
Right.
Why do they need to ask you what's on their mind?
Well, because it solidifies guilt on your part. Most police cars have a dash cam system, mm-hmm. With a microphone, and the police officer usually has a microphone on them.
Right.
If they pull you over and you say, yes, I was doing 60 in a 50, and you try to fight that in court, you're going to lose.
Well, I want to think of the mindset of, I mean, if you're sitting there, you as a traveler, somebody driving your automobile, you got to think, why are they asking me that question? And I'm getting you in the audience there to think about this. Why are they asking you that question? You know they know the answers to why they pulled you over, so why are they even asking you? Okay? So it isn't about that they don't know. Come on, they know. they want you to admit to something like you're saying.
That's right.
So just think about that for a second. If you understand that concept right there, that this isn't a legitimate question. This is a question to convict you.
Right.
I mean, that's huge. And I think if a person understands that, that question is not innocent. It's a question to convict yourself. You better realize, I better not answer that question, because I may even answer it wrongly. I may be so scared, you know, and I say, well, you may not know. Was I speeding? Was I going 10 miles over the speed limit? You know, you may have done it 5 miles ago and you were driving the speed limit right then, but you didn't know when that police officer was watching you.
Right.
He may be getting you for failure to turn your signal on.
Right.
You know, and now all of a sudden you've admitted, well, you're over the speed limit by 10 miles. Now you got an automatic ticket. You just admitted your guilt.
Yep.
When all it was going to be, you didn't turn your turn signal on. So when they ask you that question, and you said this before, that when they ask you the question, do you know why I pulled you over, your answer would be, what would you say to them?
Why did you pull me over? I always answer questions with questions.
Yeah.
And you always have the right to remain silent, too.
Okay.
You know, you don't have to talk to the police when they ask you questions.
Well, that's interesting. That will come up in our video, but why would you say, officer, I choose to remain silent or exercise my Fifth Amendment rights here? Why would you say that right away versus why did you pull me over?
Just because you don't want to talk to him. Or you may not feel comfortable in that situation. You might not know what to say, and it's easier not to say anything than to say the wrong thing.
Okay. Yeah, that's very good. I didn't think about that. So when you say, officer, I choose not to incriminate myself, I choose my Fifth Amendment rights, I want an attorney, what's that officer's responsibility then at that point in time? What are we to expect the officer to do?
During a traffic stop, to run your license and either issue you a ticket or let you go at that point in time.
It should be that simple. So if the officer keeps asking you questions after you invoked the Fifth Amendment and wanting to see an attorney or have an attorney, but he keeps asking you questions, what do you do then?
I would personally repeat, I respectfully do not want to answer any questions.
Okay. And just keep repeating that.
Just keep repeating that.
Yeah. Okay. So you get through that. The officer's still talking. You found out why they pulled you over. Maybe because you said, well, why have you pulled me over? They come up with something.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say it was speeding. Okay, what happens then?
Well, they're either going to issue a warning, a ticket, or just let you go. I still would not admit to it. I wouldn't. I would definitely remain silent at that point in time. A traffic stop is not the place to argue the law.
Okay.
The place to argue the law in guilt versus innocence is a courtroom.
Okay.
You're not going to win that argument with a police officer on the street.
So if it's speeding, they really have, if you go through the steps you've said so far, the only thing that's going to happen is they're going to give you a citation.
Right.
Or they're going to let you go.
Right.
And once they give you that, you've kind of forced their hands to settle this quickly. And they haven't been able to do any search. But let's say they're not happy that you've exercised your Fifth or that you've made them tip their hand right away and say, well, this is what you do. Well, say they accuse you, well, you were going 10 miles over the speed limit. At that point in time, you still don't admit to it.
Right, no.
You just don't say anything.
Exactly.
Okay. That reminds me, there's a video out there. I've shown it on the show in the past, but it's called Don't Talk to the Police. Just Google it, Don't Talk to the Police. And it's done by a prosecuting attorney, and it's done by a, I believe, a county sheriff, who both say, don't talk to the police, and they lay out all the legal reasons for that. And it's a fascinating video that I think everybody should watch, just so in case you don't believe us, you don't believe them. And this was done at a law school, this presentation was made. So you just say nothing.
Right.
Okay. And they really got to go about their business. But I see what happens is people go and say, well, can we search your car?
That happens a lot. I always recommend to refuse searches. Maybe your car is clean, but I'm sure everybody has had somebody in their car, and someone might have dropped something or who knows what.
Right.
If police need to ask to search your car, they don't have probable cause to search it.
Because they'll just go and do it.
Right. If they have probable cause, they're just going to
search.
Well,
they may have probable cause, but you gave consent. So, I mean, so that may be another reason they ask, is just so that gets them off the legal requirement.
It very well could be. But I would always recommend to refuse searches.
Well, that brings up another issue, is because there are bad actors once in a while.
Right.
Bad police officers. I mean, we've seen this happen in Hennepin County courtrooms, where officers have come in and thrown some drugs down by a person in a courtroom,
mm-hmm.
and try to get them in trouble. And it does.
Yes.
Until you can prove yourself innocent. But that's a horrific process to go through. So don't give them the opportunity or the temptation to do something bad.
Right.
In there. So refuse the search.
Right.
And then they can't search, right?
No. They cannot search without your permission or probable cause.
Okay.
So.
Well, we got a phone call here. So, caller, do you have a comment or question?
Yeah, this is Rich Neumeister.
I'm getting a lot
of feedback. And
yes.
I don't know what it is, but
it's the phone.
I just listened to your, I just tuned in, but I don't know, maybe Andrew would like to talk about how important it is to use the Data Practices Act to find out about behavior by government and some of the examples that he has used it. I know that he has done that in the past.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's do that here, do quickly, and then we're going to get into your video of your what time you got pulled over.
Sure.
And you'll see all this come to life that we've been talking about, and why it works and why it doesn't, or may or may not. So how did you know, you've been pulled over, but you have to protect yourself.
Right.
So you go through the data practices.
Yes, that's
routine.
That's definitely one of the tools I use. Every time that I have been in a traffic stop, I've always done a Data Practices Act request for the officer's report on that stop.
Every time.
No matter what.
Legit or not.
Yeah.
Okay.
That and the video.
Okay.
You know.
Well, it's good practice anyway.
Sure.
For when you're really going to need it.
Yes, definitely.
Okay.
And you know, sometimes the officer's report does not correlate with the video, which is very interesting.
Wow.
Yeah.
And then what do you do with it then?
You could file a complaint. That probably wouldn't go very far.
Mm-hmm.
I personally just put the videos on the internet and let the general public decide.
Okay. And you do have a website, and we didn't put it up there. YouTube.com/
The Drukes.
The Drukes, spelled
D-R-E-W-K-S.
E-W-K-S. Maybe we can remember to get that up there so people can look at some of your videos, which I think are fascinating. How do you do a data practice request?
It's pretty simple. You just write a letter to the authority for that organization. Mm-hmm. Usually with police departments, I go with the chief of police, and it will work its way to whoever the authority is. And then I just ask for the dash cam video and the police report. And, you know, in a matter of usually a week or less, I have both of them.
So there's a specific statute you cite?
Yes, Minnesota Chapter 13.
That's it?
Yep.
Minnesota Chapter 13.
That's right.
Easy enough.
Yep.
Okay. I'll have to have you help me with my first data practice request.
Definitely.
But that sounds easy enough. I should be able to do it just off that information. Mm-hmm. We're running out of time. We haven't seen your video.
Sure.
So we're going to watch that here. Mac stop number one. This is where you're getting pulled over coming out of a McDonald's.
All right.
Okay. You may want to add commentary.
Hi! Driver's license, proof of insurance, please. You bet. You pull into McDonald's like you're going to get food, and then you go around me and you decide to leave. So did you go inside and get it, or when did you get it? Excuse me? Go ahead.
Now, right here, I'm getting
so
the driver's license
and insurance
again, for the officer.
Did you go inside and get it, or how'd that work? Excuse me? Your Fifth Amendment rights? Okay, well then give me your driver's license, Mr. Fifth Amendment rights.
That was just rude.
That was.
You realize the Fifth Amendment's only for use inside a court of law, correct? Okay, Andrew? Why do you need to have the right to remain silent? What did you do illegal that you feel the need to avail yourself of the right to remain silent? Got it.
Now, what I think is interesting is that officer automatically thought that I was guilty of something, just for
their phone right.
My Fifth Amendment
right
rights
Brady,
being exercised.
377 Charles Ridge.
Well, he was trying to get you to admit. He was asking you what you did wrong.
Right.
That you need to exercise your Fifth. Well, you don't have to do anything wrong.
No. And it's not just for use in court.
Right.
Yeah.
It's anywhere.
Anywhere.
Yeah. That's a fascinating. Well, what was interesting here, which was different, because the officer came up to you and right away asked for your driver's license and insurance.
Right.
He didn't do the question, why did I pull you over?
No. I actually had to ask him.
Or do you know why I pulled you over? But because he asked you right away for your driver's license, because usually they don't ask for that first. Usually they go, do you know why I pulled you over?
Right.
Because they have to have a reason to pull you over. And you have no obligation to give you them anything, right, until they tell you why. Is that correct?
That is correct, yes.
Okay, so he hadn't done that. He just walked up, give me your license and registration.
Right.
And you properly asked him, officer, why did you pull me over?
Right.
And he said?
He said, because I went around him at McDonald's.
And didn't go through the drive-thru.
I didn't go through the drive-thru.
But it looked like you were going to and then didn't. So.
Right.
Unbelievable.
I don't see that as a probable cause or a reasonable suspicion.
No, not at all. So why do you need to exercise your Fifth was a question he asked.
Right.
And your answer was?
I just didn't want to talk. I didn't understand the situation that was going on. I didn't understand why I was being pulled over.
Exactly. And I think that's the same thing that happened to Michelle McDonald. Why are you pulling me over? And the guy couldn't articulate it. Right. Well, you don't get information if you can't tell me why you're pulling me over.
Right.
Okay. Well, let's go on to the next video then. Or was there any other points you wanted to make on this one?
No, I think I covered the points on that first part.
So you saw the initial stop.
Yep.
You got the license and everything. Okay.
Right.
So let's go to the next one.
1423 77 Northwest 3rd, shots fired.
Now, I would like to point out that the squad car that's coming as backup, you can see in the lower right-hand corner, is doing nearly 100 miles per hour through a residential area. All for, you know, me exercising my Fifth Amendment right.
First stop without probable cause.
Yeah. You know, there's no danger to the officer.
37, can you let the main or county know that I've got 2 cars? That's enough.
2 cars, that's enough.
47 minutes.
And how many cars showed up?
I think 11 squad cars in total came by.
So I stop him because I go to McDonald's to get a burger, and he drives around like he's going to get one, and then he quick zips around me and takes off out of McDonald's and decides that he's not hungry. So I pull him over because it's suspicious. Nobody's going to do that. I walk up to him, ask him for his driver's license, and he says, I plead the fifth. And I go, that's actually for you to decide a court of law. All I was going to do is ask you, he goes, why'd you stop me? So I tell him, it's awfully suspicious. People don't usually do that. So I ask him for his driver's license, and he goes, I have the right to remain silent. I'm going to do that. And I'm like, dude, what the, you know? So I'm like, you know what? Before I start asking anything else or start looking anywhere else, this guy just started off with the total... I don't know if he's a sovereign citizen or what. The other thing that's weird is when I asked him where he was going, he said he was heading home. He lives on B2. He went totally past his house. So, nothing yet, but it was like he was acting so screwy. I'm like, I don't even know.
All right, let's stop the video there for a sec. Just to hold it there. Before I started asking anything else, so he had a whole bunch of questions. He was going to do a search on you.
Right.
That's what I get out of that question. Or looking anywhere else.
Right.
He wanted to look further and to investigate more.
Yep.
He was doing a search. He just admits, I'm getting ready to do a search. And he's got no reason to pull you over except you're suspicious of being suspicious.
Pretty much, yes.
I mean, did you catch that when he was... Well, of course, that you didn't hear that conversation
right.
coming up to the car.
Right.
Okay.
I didn't catch it at the time, but, you know, looking back on the video, yeah, it differs a little than what he said. You know, I gave him my driver's license and proof of insurance immediately when
right.
he asked for it, you know. You can hear me asking him if I can go in my glove box to get it for
yeah.
him. And, you know, to his colleagues, he says that the first thing I said was, you know, I plead the fifth, which is not entirely true.
Right. That was not true. The first thing you did was give him your license.
Right.
Yeah.
And then I asked him why I was being...
And then you asked him why. And so he was setting up a different scenario. I don't know whether it was intentional or not. We really can't read his mind,
right.
which he expects us to do. You know, most police officers expect you to do is to read their mind. Why did I pull you over, for example? Then he makes a statement, I don't know if he's a sovereign citizen or what. Okay. Well, that's a statement regarding there are a group of people who, in my opinion, have taken the idea we are sovereign citizens. I mean, all of us are born with unalienable rights that are given by God. That's what sovereign being a sovereign citizen means. The government has no claim on us
right.
as a free person. But there are a group of people out there called quote-unquote sovereign citizens that are probably, can be, or may be engaged in some illegal activities that they want to do that are against the law, and these officers have every right to go in and deal with.
Mm-hmm.
But why do you jump to that conclusion?
I have no idea why you jump to that conclusion.
Because this is, everybody should be able to do what you did, and
right.
it's not even a thought.
Right.
Taken,
it's
not
simply
even an issue.
Right. It's simply exercising your rights.
Okay. All right. Let's continue on. Oh, we're running out of time. Bad time management again.
I already told them to cancel.
Andrew, what's the deal, man? Okay, you realize it's very highly unusual for someone to have the position that you're at right now, correct?
I suppose.
Okay, so why are you so oppositional for something that we would have already been done with had you not been so oppositional?
Can you make yourself more clear?
Can you make yourself more clear?
Yeah.
As far as what?
What are you talking about?
First of all, I've never had anybody claim the fifth when I asked them for their driver's license. Second of all, when I just ask somebody a couple simple questions so that I can either verify that they're not intoxicated or they're not up to something, I've never had anybody tell me that they have the right to remain silent and they're going to exercise that. Because actually, unless I've got you in custody for something, which obviously I don't, and I'm asking you questions about a specific crime, that doesn't work either, dude.
I don't want to answer any questions.
Okay. Ma'am, are you in the same boat as him?
Let's come back here. All right, we're running out of time here, so sure. Your comments on that.
What I think was really interesting about that is that he said he didn't have me in custody.
Right.
Well, there
you
was,
were stopped.
Yeah, there was four, you know, Ramsey County Sheriff's deputies around me. I was in custody. I was being detained. I wasn't going anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
I did not have the freedom to leave that situation
no.
at that time at all.
And he was asking you questions to indict you. He said that. I'm asking a couple simple questions to verify whether you're a criminal or not.
Right.
You know, whether you're intoxicated or not up to something good, you know. I mean, he just admits that he's got nothing on you. And so eventually he lets you go. He finds out who you are.
Yes.
That you recorded a sheriff deputy. Which was your legal right, had been charged with a crime for doing that and got acquitted of that in court.
Right.
So he figures, uh-oh, you know your stuff.
And
see
lets
you later.
Me go right away, yep.
And lets you go. Well, and what's this officer doing now?
Desk
10 seconds.
Job.
He's got a desk job now?
Yep.
Andrew, we're going to have you back on because we didn't get to what happens when the police come to the sidewalk or come to your home.
Because sure.
That's important, but this is a big step. You follow these things, you're going to be okay. Should be okay. At least you protected yourself and get the data practices information. Okay, remember, if you don't defend other people's liberties, who's going to defend yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week. Thank you, Andrew.
Right now, I see that you're